Welcome back to the Cloud Church. I'm Robert Breaker, Missionary Evangelist, the Spanish and English speaking people. And what we're going to do today is we're going to start the Seven Mysteries series. The Seven Mysteries. A lot of people don't know about this, and a lot of people who claim to be Christian for years have never heard about the mysteries in the Bible. And this is going to be kind of an introduction to the Seven Mysteries. And what I'd like to do is just give you an introduction today and briefly mention the Seven Mysteries. And each one of these passages is a different mystery. We're actually going to look at the verse where it says the word mystery. And then, in the next 7 weeks, we're going to look at each one individually, and we're going to go more into detail. So we're going to have maybe an hour, a little less than an hour today, looking at the seven mysteries in the Bible. And then we're going to take each Sunday, one of the mysteries, and expound on it for about an hour. So we'll learn about the seven mysteries in the Bible. And I can't stress how important these mysteries are. These are the most important thing in the Bible to learn after you get saved. Yet, how many people have ever heard of the mysteries in the Bible? Well, let's get started. And we'll have to start with 2 Timothy 2:15. So we're going to have to go to 2 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 15. And while you're turning to 2 Timothy 2:15, let me just state that I've taped all these in Spanish already. And so, in the Spanish church, we go to thecloudchurch.org, and when you go to thecloudchurch.org, it's over to the left, it says Español. Everything I preach in Spanish, we also preach in English, and vice versa. Everything I preach in English is also in Spanish. Well, I've already taped these in Spanish years ago, and so this is kind of different. Usually, I preach a message in English, and then immediately record it in Spanish right after. Well, I already have these in Spanish, so now I'm going to be doing them in English. So I'm doing a little backwards. But I believe it's important that everything that I preach in English also be preached in Spanish so that we can reach people that speak English as well as Spanish. So we're going to begin on the teaching of the seven mysteries in the Bible. And we're going to look at 2 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 15 first. Such an important verse. The Bible says, "Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth." So three things are mentioned here, three important things that we're told to do. This verse tells us to study the Bible. We are instructed to study. We're also instructed to rightly divide the word of truth. And the reason we study and rightly divide is so we're not ashamed. This is one of the best verses in the Bible. And it tells us what to do. It's to study the Bible. So we're to study. When we study the Bible, the first thing we realize is, well, there's some divisions in the Bible. Not everything in the Bible is written to us. The first division in the Bible is Old Testament, New Testament. When you look and you see, hey, this Old Testament stops and it starts a New Testament. What is that? What are the divisions in the Bible? Let's briefly look at a couple of the divisions in the Bible before we get into the mysteries in order to understand what these mysteries are and where they come from. So I'm going to start right here. I'm going to draw out the whole Bible. All right, here's Jesus Christ, died on the cross for our sins. Before Jesus, there was a time called the law. That Old Testament law started with Moses. Now before Moses, way back, the first man is Adam. So to rightly divide the word of truth, we have to see the right division. And the right division is to realize that there's the Old Testament. This is the Old Testament law. But Jesus Christ came, and the Bible says in Romans chapter 10 and verse 4 that Jesus Christ is the end of the law. So when Jesus Christ came, he started what we call today the New Testament. And we are in what we call today the church age. It's a day and age of grace. So we're no longer under that Old Testament law. If you get a chance, go to thecloudchurch.org and look under past sermons and see the sermon, The Law versus Grace. There are many people today that claim to be Christians that want to get under the Old Testament law. I don't understand that, because the Bible tells us that the law was a schoolmaster to bring us to Christ. When you come to Christ, you're no longer under the law. So we're under grace. Now, when we rightly divide the word of truth, we see that there's different dispensations. Go to thecloudchurch.org, past sermons, watch the sermon on dispensation, the different ways that God deals with people. Well, at the end of the church age is what's called the rapture. And the rapture will take place, and the Bible tells us that after the rapture, there'll be a time called the tribulation. And at the end of the tribulation, God himself will come back at the battle of Armageddon. two D's. Last time I spelled it accidentally with two G's. After that, after the Armageddon, there will be a time called the Millennial Kingdom. I'll just abbreviate that. When 1,000 years, Jesus Christ is going to rule and reign on the earth. So this is called rightly dividing the word of truth. We look at the Bible and we divide it out the way that God set it up. And as we rightly divide the word of truth, we see that part of the Bible, the Old Testament, isn't for us. We're under this part. We're not under the tribulation. We're not in the millennium today. We're not under the law. We're in this age, this time period that some call the church age, but is really an age of grace. So to understand the Bible, we must rightly divide. And to do that, we must study. And why should we be studying and rightly dividing? So we won't be ashamed. Because can you imagine not understanding the Bible and getting to heaven? And God say, well, why didn't you study? Why are you preaching this when I told you to preach this? All the Bible is given to us for us to read, but not all the Bible is written directly to us. You see, this part in the Old Testament law was written to Jews. We are not Jews today. Over here in the tribulation, that's not written to us because we're not in that time period yet. Over here in the church age, there is even a time period in the church age. If you get a chance, go to thecloudchurch.org. Go to it's not under past sermons. I believe it's under Bible studies. And look up the Bible study on understanding the book of Acts. Because there's a transition in the book of Acts. You see, when Jesus Christ started his church, he used Peter and the early apostles to start the church. And when he did, they went to Jews only. But gradually, in the book of Acts, we see a change to Gentiles. And we see God bringing up a man named Paul. And do you know that guy Paul is so important? Matter of fact, these mysteries were revealed to Paul. All of the seven that I'm going to give you were revealed to Paul except for one. I'm going to give you one that was revealed to the Apostle John. But these seven mysteries, God chose a man named Paul to reveal some mysteries to. And so that's what we're going to study today. We're going to look at. Let's begin in Ephesians chapter 3. And we've got to remember that today we are under the ministry of Paul. There are a lot of churches that are on the wrong foundation. A lot of churches try to say, well, we started with Peter. Well, if you get a chance, go to thecloudchurch.org, go to past sermons, and look up the sermon on Peter versus Paul. I believe you've got another one there, and it's something to the effect of Paul's ministry and how today we are under Paul's ministry. The Apostle Paul, and we'll look at this here in a minute, but I'll go ahead and jump ahead a little bit and get off my notes. According to Romans 11:13, he is the apostle to the Gentiles. Well, if you're a Gentile, then you should be following the Apostle Paul, because the Apostle Paul is the apostle to Gentiles. There's a lot of churches today, a lot of denominations, a lot of so-called Christians. They don't know what to do with Paul. They don't understand. So a lot of them try to spend all their time in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. But they don't realize that God used Paul, revealed some things to Paul, and Paul wrote several books, Romans through Philemon. And the doctrine of the church age today is in these books. This is where we get our New Testament doctrine. Because God used Paul to settle the doctrine in the church age. So the other books in the New Testament, a lot of them deal with this time period when God began the church dealing with Jews. A lot of them talk about out here. But if you want the right doctrine for today, you have to go through the Apostle Paul's writings. And we'll look at that. So Paul is so important. And if you don't understand that, like I said, go to thecloudchurch.org, past sermons, and look at the one, Paul's ministry, Peter versus Paul. I believe even on the front page of thecloudchurch.org, there's something to the effect of following Paul and rightly dividing the word of truth. So there's many different videos that talk about this. So you'll understand. And I'll try to explain it a little bit today. But let's look at this. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 1 through 10. Ephesians chapter 3, verses 1 through 10. The Apostle Paul is speaking, and Paul says, For this cause I, Paul, the prisoner of Jesus Christ, for you Gentiles, if you have heard of the dispensation of the grace of God which is given me to you ward, how that by revelation he made known unto me the mystery. Now who is he? God. God gave some mysteries to Paul. He revealed some mysteries to the Apostle Paul. And those revelations through Paul are for us that are alive today in the church age. That's why Paul is so important. Now, I don't understand, don't know why God chose to do it that way. He could have very well used Peter and revealed those things to Peter, but he didn't. God chose a man named Paul and said, now, Paul, I'm going to reveal some things to you that were mysteries before the foundation of the world. And I want my people, the Christians who are saved in the church age, to hear my mysteries. And I chose you, Paul, to put them in the Bible. That's why we have the Apostle Paul. Well, don't you think we should read Paul and find out what these mysteries are? I think so. So it says there in verse 3, how that by revelation he made known unto me the mystery as I wrote afore in few words. Whereby when you read, you may understand my knowledge in the mystery of Christ, which in other ages was not made known unto the sons of men, as it is now revealed unto his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit, that the Gentiles should be fellow heirs of the same body and partakers of his promise in Christ by the gospel. So God chose this man, Paul, as the apostle to the Gentiles, and God told him, look, I want you to go preach the gospel. And we'll look at that in a minute. What is the gospel for today? Well, this is the gospel for today. It was preached by Paul, and if you want to be saved today, you have to go through the Pauline gospel. You have to come through the gospel that was revealed to Paul, which, by the way, is found in 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 4. So let's look at this. It says here in verse 6, the end of it, partakers of his promise in Christ by the gospel. So what is the gospel? Well, let's start there. The gospel is found in 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 4, which, by the way, is a book of Paul. And look at what this says in 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 4. There are many, many groups today that claim to be Christians that aren't preaching this gospel. Paul said that it was revealed to him by God. Paul says in Romans 2:16 that the whole world someday will be judged according to his gospel. He said, according to my gospel. So that sounds like that's pretty important. If you want to be saved today, you have to come through the gospel that God revealed to Paul. Because Paul said that God will judge the entire world according to his gospel. What is Paul's gospel? It's found in 1 Corinthians 15, and it's in verses 1 through 4. And I'll read it quickly. Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you, which also you have received and wherein you stand, by which also you are saved. So the only way to be saved today is through Paul's gospel. Or let's just call it the gospel of Jesus Christ revealed to Paul. So let's look at this. It says in verse 4, for I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day, according to the Scriptures. So what is the gospel? The gospel is the death, the burial, and the actual resurrection of Jesus Christ. That's the gospel. It's what Jesus Christ did for us when he died on the cross. So let me just talk real quickly a little bit about this right here. It's the blood atonement of Jesus Christ. You get a chance, go to cloudchurch.org, past sermons, look up the sermon about blood atonement. I got a sermon there on the gospel. I believe that was the first sermon we preached. And the gospel is all about the blood atonement of Jesus Christ. Blood atonement is what salvation is all about. All throughout the Old Testament, God chose a means to be saved. In Hebrews 9:22, it says, without the shedding of blood, there's no remission of sins. So whenever a man sinned, God demanded a sacrifice of blood. And it was the blood that made atonement for their sins. It was the blood that forgive sins. So forgiveness is only through blood sacrifice. Way back here, under Moses, it was always the blood of a lamb or a goat. But it was always an animal. Let's say a lamb. Well, when Jesus Christ showed up, the Bible says that John the Baptist said, behold, the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. So Jesus Christ came and died as the Lamb, and his one sacrifice forever is all that's necessary for salvation. It's all what Jesus Christ did for our sins. He was buried and rose again the third day, according to Scriptures. You get a chance, go to cloudchurch.org. Look at past sermons on the one about imputed righteousness, how when you trust Christ and trust the gospel, he imputes to you his righteousness. Look at the one about redemption and how you're redeemed. Look at the one called justification and how you're justified by the blood of Jesus Christ. So salvation is through Jesus Christ, through the gospel. And what is the gospel? The gospel tells us of the blood atonement of Jesus Christ. I've given my testimony. You can go to cloudchurch.org, past sermons, look up my testimony. How I got saved reading Romans 3:25, and how important that blood is. Ephesians 1:7 tells us that the blood of Jesus Christ is the only thing that can give you forgiveness. It says, in whom we have redemption through His blood, even the forgiveness of sins. You know, that's what the world is looking for, is forgiveness of sins. That's what all religions want, is forgiveness of sins. And they all have one thing in common. They ignore Jesus Christ. Because just about every religion teaches that you can get forgiveness of your sins based on something you do yourself, your works. And what is the gospel? It's the exact opposite. The gospel is, don't trust in what you do, trust what Jesus did, because you can only be forgiven through trusting in His blood atonement, what He did for you when He died for your sins. But I got saved in Romans 3:25. It says, whom God has set forth to be a propitiation. What does that mean? It means like a substitute. Jesus Christ was our substitute. It literally means the act of appeasing wrath. Jesus Christ died in my place on the cross, and God poured out His wrath on my sins, on Jesus, in my place. And so I read Romans 3:25, whom God has set forth to be a propitiation through faith in His blood, to declare His righteousness for the remission of sins that are past through the forbearance of God. So, through faith in His blood. So the gospel is trusting what Jesus did. What did He do? He made a blood atonement. He died, was buried, and rose again, according to the Scripture. So I'm trusting the gospel. I'm trusting the blood for my salvation, for my forgiveness. And I'm forgiven, I'm saved, and I know it. So I thank God that I'm saved. So this is something that's important. Now, does your pastor preach this? Maybe you're a pastor or Sunday school teacher watching this video. Do you preach this? This is oh so important. I mean, I can't tell you how important it is to preach the gospel. So let's go now to 1 Peter. 1 Peter. The gospel, when I say the gospel, I refer to 1 Corinthians 15:1 through 4. And that's the gospel that God revealed to Paul. Now, that doesn't mean that Peter and the early apostles weren't preaching it. You can't go through the book of Acts without hearing Peter and the early apostles talk about Him who you killed and was buried and rose again. But they were preaching more to Jews, and they were preaching more about who Jesus was. They were preaching to the Jews about who He was. He was their Messiah. But what God did with Paul was He changed the emphasis of who Jesus was, the Messiah of the Jews, a Jewish Messiah for Jews, to what Jesus did for all. So this gospel of Paul, the emphasis is more on what Jesus did for us. So there was a change. If you get a chance, go to cloudchurch.org, past sermons, and you can look at the sermon, the difference between the who and the what of salvation. But anyway, we're going to 1 Peter chapter 1. And let's begin there in verse 7. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 7. Talking about mysteries and how God revealed some mysteries to the Apostle Paul. And in verse 7 through 13, look what it says here, 1 Peter 1:7. The trial of your faith, being much more precious than of gold that perisheth, though it be tried with fire, might be found unto praise and honor and glory at the appearing of Jesus Christ, whom having not seen, ye love, in whom though now ye see Him not, yet believing, ye rejoice with joy unspeakable and full of glory, receiving the end of your faith, even the salvation of your souls. Now watch what he says. Of which salvation the prophets have inquired and searched diligently, who prophesied of the grace that should come unto you. They prophesied of the grace that would come. And he says, searching what or what manner of time the Spirit of Christ which was in them did signify when it testified beforehand the sufferings of Christ and the glory that should follow. So these Old Testament prophets prophesied of this coming death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus, of His sufferings, of His sacrifice. But they didn't know what they were prophesying about. Now, over here, we can look back and we can see the prophecies and say, wow, God is true! Because thousands of years before, He prophesied that certain things would happen, and they came to pass. So this gospel was hidden from the Old Testament. There's people that say, well, they're saved the same in the Old Testament as the New Testament. Really? How could they be if the gospel was hidden in the Old Testament? Get a chance, go to cloudchurch.org and look at the past sermon that I made called Dispensational Salvation, and how salvation was different in the Old Testament, because they couldn't trust the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus because He hadn't died yet, nor had He risen again. They were under the law. So, right here again in verse 11, it says, when it testified beforehand the sufferings of Christ and the glory that should follow. Verse 12 says, unto whom it was revealed, that not unto themselves, but unto us they did minister the things which are now reported unto you by them that have preached the gospel unto you with the Holy Ghost sent down from heaven, which things the angels desire to look into. So the angels in the Old Testament were watching these men write down the Bible. And God inspired His Word in them to write it down. And the angels were saying, what is this? What's happening? It wasn't until Jesus showed up and He actually died on the cross and was buried and rose again that the angels said, whoa, I remember that being written down years before. Well, yeah, the Holy Spirit had them write that, and it was prophecy of this that was about to come. But who was it written to? Well, Peter says it was written unto us. They were ministering to us. And then verse 13 says, wherefore, gird up the loins of your mind, be sober, and hope to the end for the grace that is to be brought unto you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. So, Jesus Christ is coming back, and He's coming back for the Jews. And we'll look at that in a minute. So, there were mysteries or things that God kept hidden in the Old Testament, but that were later revealed through Jesus Christ. And were later revealed to the Apostle Paul for us today. So, Jesus Christ shed His blood on the cross. We are saved today not by sacrificing like they did under the law. They had to take an animal and sacrifice. We are saved today by trusting the sacrifice of Jesus Christ who suffered and bled and died. Now let's take a little closer look at Paul real quick. Like I said, there's some people that don't even know why Paul is in the Bible. I saw a thing on YouTube. There was this preacher that he took like an hour and a half sermon, and his thesis or his topic was why Paul shouldn't even be in the Bible. You see, he didn't rightly divide the word of truth. He didn't understand. So he didn't understand how Paul wrote certain things because they didn't jive with other things. So he said, Paul shouldn't even be in the Bible. I reject Paul completely. Well, guess what he just rejected? These mysteries. And he's going to be lacking. And he's going to be ashamed someday. Because God chose Paul, and you cannot deny the Apostle Paul. Who was Paul? Romans 11:13. I quoted it earlier, but I want to read it to you. And if you've got your Bible, I'd like you to look with me. Romans chapter 11 and verse 13. The Apostle Paul is writing, and he says, for I speak unto you Gentiles, and as much as I am the apostle of the Gentiles, I magnify my office. So Paul is an apostle. He's our apostle. He's the apostle to the Gentiles. Now let's go to Romans chapter 16 and verse 25. Again, the Apostle Paul is speaking. And keep in mind, we're talking about mysteries, certain mysteries that were kept secret, and God revealed them to Paul. In Romans chapter 16 and verse 25, it says, now to him that is of power to establish you according to my gospel and the preaching of Jesus Christ, according to the revelation of the mystery which was kept secret since the world began, but now is made manifest and by the scriptures of the prophets according to the commandment of the everlasting God made known to all nations for the obedience of faith. So Paul is saying there was a mystery that was kept secret since the world began. And Paul says, this is my gospel and I'm preaching this. It all ties in to what was the mystery. Well, it was a mystery in the Old Testament that Jesus Christ was going to come and bleed and die and raise again. But now it's been revealed. And according to the Apostle Paul, we can only be saved by what God revealed to Paul, that gospel. Let me show you that. Go to Galatians chapter 1. There's a lot of people that don't believe Paul, and they refuse to accept the Apostle Paul. Well, guess what they're doing? They're denying it to their own detriment because they're rejecting the gospel of salvation for us today. Because Paul said, my gospel, that's how you're saved. If you're a Gentile today, you can only come to Jesus Christ through the gospel that God revealed to Paul, 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 4. Well, in Galatians chapter 1, and we've gone verse by verse in our Bible studies, and we began in the book of Galatians. If you get a chance, go to cloudchurch.org, go to the click on where it says verse by verse Bible study, and you can actually go verse by verse with us through the epistle of Paul to the Galatians. And it's amazing and it's wonderful to study the Bible verse by verse. No greater way to study the Bible than verse by verse. But in here in Galatians chapter 1 and verse 11, Paul is speaking and Paul says, but I certify you, brethren, that the gospel which was preached of me is not after man. For neither I received it of man, neither was I taught it, but by the revelation of Jesus Christ. So God, as I just told you, revealed unto Paul the gospel. You say, well, wasn't the gospel preached before Paul? Of course. Peter and the early apostles preached the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. But they also preached you got to be baptized in water and trust in your Messiah. And slowly, as the transgression took place through the book of Acts, and like I said, go to cloudchurch.org and look up under Bible studies, the one about understanding the book of Acts, there was a change. A change from Jews to Gentiles. No longer was water baptism necessary for the remission of sins. The water's no good. It's the blood. And so God showed them, look, no longer is it for Jews only salvation. Salvation is to Gentiles. And the way to be saved is through the gospel, not through water baptism, not through speaking in tongues, not through this or that. It's trusting in what Jesus did for us when he died for us in our place for our sins. But the Apostle Paul tells us here that the gospel which he preached wasn't of man. God revealed it to him. So what are you doing trying to say Paul shouldn't be in the Bible? You're denying the way of salvation that God gave for us today. You cannot come to God today for salvation unless you come through the writings of Paul. Unless you accept something that God revealed unto Paul. Wow, what an amazing statement, but what a great Bible truth. So I've got up here 7 different mysteries in the Bible. Like I said, 6 of them were revealed to Paul. There's one that I added that was actually from the Apostle John. So what are these mysteries? Well, let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 4. 1 Corinthians chapter 4. And one thing I'd like to say that's so important is any man who claims to be a minister of the gospel, any person who claims to be a pastor and a Christian, there is something you need to preach. And that's this gospel, and you need to preach these mysteries. And we're going to look at this. And yet today, so few actually do, because so few actually know what the mysteries are. Look with me at 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 1 through 2. The Apostle Paul is speaking. He says, let a man so account of us as of the ministers of Christ and stewards of the mysteries of God. Moreover, it is required in stewards that a man be found faithful. So the Apostle Paul, our Apostle, is speaking. And look what he says. He says, if you are a man of God, you need to be a minister. And you need to be a steward of what? Of the mysteries. And you need to be faithful in preaching those mysteries. Now how many of you people watching this have ever heard your preacher ever preach any one of the mysteries? Have you ever sat in a church and ever in your life heard a pastor or a guest speaker or an evangelist ever talk about, today we're going to look at the mysteries of God revealed to us today through the Apostle Paul? Chances are, probably never. How sad that we live today in an age in which people don't preach the Bible. And Paul, it told us, but you got to be faithful preaching the mysteries. Well, people aren't very faithful today because they don't even know what they are, majority of them. We're right here at the end of the church age. The Bible says at the end of the church age, there'll be a time of apostasy and a great falling away from the faith. What does that mean? That means they're not going to be faithful. So they've fallen away from the faith. So would you like to know what these mysteries are? Today is just an introduction of the 7 mysteries. I'm just going to mention what they are, show you in the Bible where it actually says in each passage the word mystery. And then next time we'll go through each one of them because these mysteries are exciting. They're amazing. They're wonderful. And you know what? When you understand these mysteries, it's impossible to fall into false doctrine. It is impossible to be deceived. If you understand these mysteries, you can't get deceived. The problem with the world today is that all the different churches, they don't rightly divide the word of truth. You've got a church called the Seventh-day Adventists, and that church believes they're still under the law. They don't understand the mysteries. They don't even read the Bible because the Bible says we're no longer under the law. The law is a curse. And when you're saved, Christ redeems you from the curse of the law. Christ is the end of the law to all who believe. So why would they want to be back here? They don't rightly divide the word of truth. They don't understand the mysteries. If you understand the mysteries, you can't be deceived and fallen into that. Sadly, many of them are lost because they're not coming through the gospel. You have a church, a big denomination called Charismatics or Pentecostals, whatever you want to call them. And they believe that today you can be saved by faith, but you can lose it. So for them, salvation is faith plus works. Well, I'm sorry, but that's not what the Bible says. One of the mysteries revealed unto Paul was that when you're saved, you receive the Holy Spirit at the actual moment you believe. And you're sealed with that Holy Spirit, and you can't lose it. Jesus Christ is in you, and you are in Him. And you can never get out, and He can never get out. But over here in the tribulation, there'll be a time period in the future after the rapture where people will believe, but then they can lose it by their works. Someone wasn't rightly dividing when they set up that Pentecostal movement. They have a gospel that's way over here. They're not living according to the gospel of here today. You've got another movement called the Jehovah Witnesses. I call them the Jehovah Windbags. All they do is talk, and boy, do they twist the scriptures. They don't preach the seven mysteries. And guess what they want to do? They want to tell you about this time over here. Let's all live in the kingdom. Oh, let's endure to the end and live in the kingdom with God. What are they doing? They're not rightly dividing. We're not in the kingdom. We're over here. We're in the kingdom of God. That's called the kingdom of heaven in the Bible. And they want you to endure to the end and come into the kingdom. Someone doesn't understand the mysteries. Where are they preaching the gospel? They don't. They reject the gospel. Matter of fact, Jehovah Witnesses say that Jesus Christ isn't God. They say that Jesus Christ is not God, and they reject the Trinity. Well, the very first one of the mysteries is there is a Trinity and Jesus Christ is God. And we'll look at that. So you see how it's so important to learn the mysteries. And when you know these mysteries, you're not going to fall into a false denomination that teaches something that's not true. So 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 1 and 2, I'll read it one more time. Let a man so account of us as of the ministers of Christ and the stewards of the mysteries of God. Moreover, it is required in stewards that a man be found faithful. That's what a minister of the gospel should be. That's what a pastor and a preacher should be. He should be faithful in preaching these mysteries that I'm going to mention today. So if you are a pastor, a Sunday school teacher, evangelist, if you're just a layman, these are things that you need to study and learn, and you need to make sure you teach to other people. It's that important. So let's start. Let's go to the first one. And the first one is 1 Timothy 3:16. So let's go to 1 Timothy chapter 3. And I will not go into detail in these. That's what the next teaching times are for. I'll go into detail in each one of these and try to explain it as well as possible. But the problem is, it's a mystery. And sometimes it's hard to explain a mystery. I can tell you what it is and what the Bible says about it, but I can't tell you how it is what it is. God does miracles, and I don't understand how He does it or why He does it. So there's some things that God does that we can't explain. All we can do is just believe it. So I believe these mysteries. I might not be able to explain them completely, but I believe them. Like some guy said, how do you explain the Trinity? Well, the Bible tells us it's true. The Bible says there's three parts, and God has three parts. The Bible says in 1 Timothy 5:23 that we are in God's image, and so we have the three parts. We're body, soul, and spirit. That means God's a body, soul, and spirit. But we can't take ourselves and split ourselves into three different parts, but God can. And that's what God did. God the Father stayed in heaven when He sent God the Son down to earth, and then God the Holy Spirit was the one that came down and impregnated Mary so that God the Son could be born here on earth. One God, three parts, but He can separate Himself, and we can't. And that's what our first one is going to be about, the mystery of the deity of Christ, the mystery of the Trinity. So let's go to 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16. And by the way, let me say that this verse has been messed with all new versions of the Bible. Unless you have a King James Bible, you do not have a pure reading of this scripture. They take the word God and they change it to He. Now why do they do that? There's one manuscript. And that one manuscript, you even look at that manuscript, you can see they erased the word God. And instead of Theos, they changed it to Hos, which means He. You can totally tell someone erased that. All other manuscripts of the Bible use the word God. This is so important because this is speaking of the deity of Jesus Christ. 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16 says, "And without controversy," so let's don't have any controversy, "without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifest in the flesh, justified in the spirit, seen of angels, preached unto the Gentiles, believed in the world, and received up unto glory." So great is the mystery of godliness. This is called the mystery of godliness. And it has to do with the deity, hope I spelled that right, of Jesus Christ. And it mentions Christ was buried and rose again, according to the scriptures. So this is all about the deity of Jesus Christ. God manifest in the flesh. Is Jesus Christ God? Of course He is. Jesus is God. There are so many verses that tell us about that. Unless you're a Jehovah's Witness, then you reject the fact that Jesus Christ is God. So when we talk about this one, we're going to talk about the Trinity a little bit. We're going to talk about the deity of Christ. And that's what we'll discuss. This was a mystery that God revealed. Why was it a mystery? Well, we talked about a little bit before that in the Old Testament, people wrote about the Messiah coming and his sufferings and his death, but nobody really understood what they were writing, that God himself would actually come down to the earth in the form of a man and die for the sins of mankind. What a thing to think that God himself came down and died on the cross for our sins. You see, all the pagans have false gods, evil gods, gods that say, we need sacrifice and we need it now. And those pagan, false, evil gods demanded human sacrifice. So they were so cruel and so cold and so wicked that they demanded you kill somebody to appease them. But look at the love of God. God loved us enough that rather than saying kill somebody else, he came down and said, I'll die in your place because I love you so much. The Bible says greater love had no man than this, that he lay down his life for his friends. Well, even when we weren't friends, we were still enemies. He loved us enough to die for us. What a thing to think about. So the first one is the mystery of godliness. This would be the number one. That's the number one mystery. It has to do with God manifest in the flesh. So it starts with the birth of Jesus. And it goes all the way to the resurrection of Jesus Christ. The first mystery. The mystery of godliness. Let's look at the second one, Colossians. And I hope you saw the word mystery. Great is the mystery of godliness. The Bible talks about mysteries. And while you're looking at Colossians chapter 1, verse 26 to 27, let me just say this. Those pagans in the Old Testament had what they called their own mysteries. So I'm not a Rosicrucian. I'm not an Egyptian. They called them the Elysium mysteries. And these mysteries were mysteries about their pagan gods. And you would follow these false mysteries. They called it the craft, which, by the way, today has to do with masonry. They call that a craft. And if you are a mason, then you know they teach you certain mysteries. Well, these are the false pagan mysteries. The devil always takes something of God and imitates it and twists it. So what do you want? Do you want the false pagan mysteries or do you want the true mysteries of the Bible? If you go to these false pagan mysteries, they will always try to tell you to come to the light. And if you study those pagan mysteries, especially masonry, you know what they'll tell you? Mason. The Masons believe that the light is Lucifer. So any mystery that someone teaches you that tries to point you to Lucifer, which is Satan, that's a false mystery. That's not the mysteries of the Bible. These mysteries that I'm presenting unto you today are in the Bible, and they point to Jesus, not to Satan. So that's something to point out as very important. Now, Colossians 1, 26 and 27. Actually, the word mystery is mentioned twice here. And the Apostle Paul, let me start in verse 25. Apostle Paul says, wherefore I am made a minister according to the dispensation of God, which is given to me for you to fulfill the word of God. So Paul is our minister. He's our apostle and he's our minister. God gave us the Apostle Paul because God used Paul to reveal some of his mysteries. And God wants us to know those mysteries. That's why we need to go to God through Paul, through those mysteries. And it says, verse 26, even the mystery which hath been hid from ages and from generations, but now is made manifest to his saints, to whom God would make known what is the riches of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. So this right here is the mystery of the indwelling. The mystery of the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. When we get saved according to the writings of Paul in the church age today, through the gospel that God revealed to Paul, and the moment you're saved, the moment you believe, the Holy Spirit of God comes inside you and dwells in you. That's what the Bible teaches. Ephesians 1:13 tells us that the moment you trust Christ as your Savior, you are sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. The Holy Spirit of promise is inside you. I'm really close, so let me look there. Ephesians 1:13. It says, in whom ye also trusted, after that ye heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation. In whom also, after that ye believed, you were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise. Now that's a mystery. You see, in the Old Testament, the Holy Spirit came and went and came and went and came and went. No one was sealed with the Holy Spirit in the Old Testament. They could get the Holy Spirit, all the people that wrote the Bible, the Holy Spirit of God came inside them and wrote through them the inspired words of God. But today, when we get the Holy Spirit, it stays with us, and we're sealed until the day of redemption, until the rapture, until we get out of here. So that's something that God revealed unto Paul, and that's so important. You know, there's denominations out there that say you can get saved, but you still don't have the Holy Spirit. Well, why are they saying that? Because they're not going to Paul. They're not going through the writings of Paul. They're not looking at the doctrine for the church age for us today. So the number two mystery is in the church age. It has to do with receiving the Holy Spirit of God. The moment you believe, you're sealed. The Holy Spirit of God comes inside and dwells in you. Now let's go to the third mystery. This is found in Ephesians chapter 5. Ephesians 5:32. I could read the whole passage, but I'll just read the one verse that mentions a mystery. In Ephesians 5:32, it says, "This is a great mystery, but I speak concerning Christ and the church." Well, starting there in verse 22, all the way down to that verse we just read, it talks about Christ and His church, and how the type of Christ in the church is a type of the marriage relationship between a man and a woman. Well, where is that? That's found over here. That's the church age. And in the church age, this mystery has to do with what's called the body of Christ. And by the way, that's also called the bride of Christ. Christ's bride is the church, the body. Get a chance, go to cloudchurch.org and go to Bible studies and look up the Bible studies about when the church started and what is the church and what is the bride of Christ. And you can learn more about this mystery of how when Jesus died, He died for a purpose. He died so that those people that would accept Him as their Savior would be part of His body. And when you're married in the marriage relationship, the Bible says you're one flesh. So man and woman come together, they're one flesh, they're one body. So when you come through the gospel and trust Jesus as your Savior, He is in you. He dwells inside you, Jesus. And you're in Him. You're one flesh. You're one body. You're a part of the body of Christ. Amazing. Interesting. Like I said, hard to explain, but it's true. It's what the Bible teaches. So we've got three mysteries. One, two, three. What's this next one? Well, this is the mystery of the rapture. And we'll look at it in just a second. I forgot to write up here what this one was. This is the mystery of the body of Christ. And like I say, if you're enjoying this, and I hope you are, then please come back each week. So for the next 7 weeks, we're going to be looking at each one of these seven mysteries. And I hope that'll be a blessing to you. So the next one is found in 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 51. 1 Corinthians 15, 51. This is the mystery of the rapture. Nobody in the Old Testament knew that there would be a body of Christ, even though there were some prophecies about it. No one in the Old Testament knew that there'd be a rapture. They didn't even know of the sufferings of Christ. They wrote about it, but didn't really understand what they were writing about. These things were revealed after, through Jesus. And many of these things were revealed by Jesus to the Apostle Paul. Paul is so important. So 1 Corinthians 15 and verse 51. And it says, "Now this I say, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, neither doth corruption inherit incorruption. Behold, I show you all a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye," I put verse 51. I need to also put up here verse 52 as well, because that's where the actual word mystery is found. Because as you read the rest of this passage, it talks about the dead in Christ rising, and then we are which are alive and remain shall be caught up with Him in the air and be changed. This is the rapture. This is what the Bible talks about of the rapture. When Jesus returns to this earth and takes out His bride. And the rapture is coming soon, friend. Real soon. I hope we finish up this series of seven mysteries. It might happen before we finish. But Jesus Christ is coming back at the rapture. He's going to take the church, His bride, out, the body of Christ. And then after that, there'll be a time called the tribulation. And that actually brings us to the next one. Well, these next ones all have to deal with something that takes place after the rapture. But also they have a little bit to talk about before the rapture. But these things are all future in most ways. So in Romans 11:25, let's look at another mystery. Romans 11:25. I hope you're with me. I hope this is understandable. I know I'm talking a little fast. But we have a mystery of godliness, indwelling body of Christ, rapture. This next one has to do with Israel. And it has to do with the restoration of Israel. And in order to understand this, we need to understand that when Jesus Christ came, Jesus was a Jew who came to Jews. He said he came only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. And so the Jews as a nation rejected their Messiah, and when they did, God chose salvation to the Gentiles and took to Gentiles salvation. But God is not through with the Jews. There's a certain gigantic church in the world today, centered in Rome, that does not believe that. They believe God is indeed done with the Jews. And that church believes that all the promises to the Jews went to them. And they believe that the Jews will never be a nation and never have anything again. Well, that's not what the Bible says. Romans chapter 11 and verse 25, the Bible says, I can find it here, "For I would not, brethren, that you should be ignorant of this mystery, lest you should be wise in your own conceits, that blindness in part has happened to Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles be come in. And so all Israel shall be saved." And as you read through this chapter, like I said, there's not time. When we get to it, we'll discuss it more in detail. God is going to begin dealing with the Jews as a nation again after the rapture. In 1948, the Jews became a nation after thousands of years. And, Jesus mentioned something about 70 years being one generation. That means 2018 would be one whole generation that they've been. Some people think 2018's got to be the rapture. It could be even before that, because the tribulation is supposed to be 7 years. And it's cut in half, 3.5 years and 3.5 years. Well, if the Jews, according to the book of Revelation, are for 3.5 years in Israel worshiping, then you'd have to back that number up. Because the Bible says that the devil, the Antichrist, kicks them out, and he rules the last 3.5 years. So that would be about 2015. Oh, the rapture is close. The rapture is close if our calendar is right. It's got to be one of those two dates. I mean, it just got to. But even if it's not, Jesus is coming. He promised he would. The rapture is coming. Maybe our calendar screwed up and all our dates are wrong. But Jesus is coming at the rapture. And when he does, and he takes the church back up into heaven, on this earth, Jesus Christ is going to deal with Israel again. And he's going to deal with them and work with them, and even let them make it through the tribulation, because when he comes back, he sits on the throne of David. So he'll rule and reign in Jerusalem for 1,000 years. Back to Israel. We call this the restoration of Israel. God will again deal with the Jews, with Israel. A lot more I could say about that, and we'll get to it eventually, Lord willing. So let's go to Revelation 17:5 to the next one. Revelation chapter 17 and verse 5. Now, you may not believe what I just said, but we are starting to see in the world today that God is indeed dealing with those Jews. And they've got their nation back, and it seems like all the prophecies in the Bible are coming to pass so that everything will happen exactly the way God said. But can you imagine? 70 A.D., the Jews lost their land. 70 A.D., the destruction of Jerusalem. It's been that long since 70 A.D. to 19. So, what is it? 1,800-something years that they haven't had a nation. And then in 1948, we saw a miracle. Israel became a nation again. They got their land back. So it shows you we're close to that rapture. Because in this tribulation period, what we're about to read on the last one here is prophecy of Israel being in Jerusalem and the things that will happen to them. But this one right here, this is Revelation chapter 17 and verse 5, and this is a mystery that was revealed to John. It was actually revealed to the Apostle John instead of Paul. And this is a mystery that talks about a religious whore. And this religious whore has been around since pretty much 325 AD, maybe even before. And it's a false church. And it's a false church that started when the true church started, and it's going to go all the way out into the tribulation. And I believe this false church will have over it the Antichrist. The Antichrist will use this false church. What does the Bible say about it? Well, 17:5, "And upon her head was a name written, Mystery Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots and abominations of the earth." So this is a mystery And it's a mystery about a woman, a whore, but as you read through it, it's a woman that joined with the states of the world. She was a political whore that looked religious, but at the same time was working with the state. It was its church-state setup. And what did she do? She killed the saints. Verse 9 says she had seven heads, or the beast had seven heads, and that the woman sat on seven mountains. Well, folks, there's only one place in the entire world known throughout history as the city of seven hills or seven mountains. Would you like to know who that is? That's called Rome, the city of Rome. Hey, Rome, well, that's who was in power when Jesus came the first time. So when he comes back again, that's who's going to be in power. Rome. So who is this whore? Well, when we get to that one, we'll look at it and learn more about that great whore of Babylon, Mystery Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots. She's not just a harlot, she's a mother. She has many churches under her as well. And as we see in these last days, the falling away from the truth of the gospel, we see this mother whore embracing other religious denominations and pulling them into herself as people turn from the scriptures. Now, the last one here is called the mystery of iniquity. And it is found, of course, in 2 Thessalonians 2:7, and it has to do with the Antichrist. So we're going to look at that in detail when we get to that one. And it's talking more about over here in the tribulation. So this mystery will apply over here in the tribulation, but really, according to the Apostle John, all throughout this church age, there have been antichrists, plural. Even today, there are even people that are alive that claim, I am the Messiah, I am Jesus Christ. What does it say about this antichrist? 2 Thessalonians 2 and verse 7. For the mystery of iniquity doth already work, only he who now letteth will let until he be taken out of the way. Then shall that wicked be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth, and shall destroy with the brightness of his coming, even him whose coming is after the working of Satan, with all power and signs and lying wonders. Who is this talking about? Well, whoever this iniquity is, this evil one, the wicked one, it says it's the wicked, W-I-C-K-E-D. Whoever it is, they're going to be destroyed by God, by Christ, when he comes back at Armageddon. Well, who's going to be destroyed at Armageddon? The Antichrist. You see, the Bible tells us that after the rapture, God is going to actually allow the devil to rule for 7 years. That's what the devil always wanted, was to be in charge. And so God's going to say, I'm taking my church out, and I'll let you have the whole mess for 7 years and see what you do with it. And then the Bible tells us in Revelation, the Antichrist will actually sit on the mercy seat in heaven, in Jerusalem, excuse me, in Jerusalem, not in heaven, in Jerusalem, and say that he is God. And then the Bible tells us that Jesus Christ is going to come back and cast them into the lake of fire and kick him out, and God's going to rule and reign for 1,000 years. So there is an Antichrist that's coming in the future to reign, and he's going to get 7-year tribulation a reign. But here are many other Antichrists throughout history. And who are they? Well, they're led by seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. We're told in the last days that there are many seducing spirits and many doctrines of devils, many denominations that teach many different things. Why? Because they're led by demonic spirits. And many of them pertain to that whore church, a church that's run by unclean spirits. So we're going to get into detail in each one of these different mysteries. As we start next time, we'll take the first one, the mystery of godliness. We'll talk about that. We'll talk about how Jesus Christ was born of a virgin, a miracle in itself. And we'll talk about the deity of Christ, how Jesus Christ is indeed God. We'll talk about the Trinity. What is the Trinity? And we'll talk about those things. And then we'll just, every week, look at a different one of these seven mysteries. But I hope this has been a blessing to you. I write a lot. It's all bundled together, so I hope you can see it. But this has been an introduction to the seven mysteries in the Bible, and we'll begin going through each one in order. But I just want to say this, and I'll close. Can you see how important these things are? If you know these mysteries, you get a whole overview, not only of what has happened, but what will happen in the future. These mysteries talk about prophecy. They also talk about practicality, mystery of the body of Christ. Mentions a lot about marriage. when a man and a woman are married, how they're a type of Christ. So all these mysteries, if you know these mysteries and understand these mysteries, it's impossible to be deceived into a false religion. It's impossible to accept a false religious whore church and follow that church. If you learn these mysteries, you can be a faithful minister and steward of the teachings of God. So have you studied? Have you rightly divided? Do you want to be ashamed someday, or do you not want to not be ashamed? Well, if you don't want to be ashamed someday, if you're a Christian and you stand before God, then why don't you learn these mysteries? We are to be faithful stewards of these mysteries. So I appreciate you watching. I hope that once again this has been a blessing to you. And I'm just chomping at the bit. I just can't wait to get started on each one of these. So for the next 7 weeks, we're going to go through the seven mysteries in the Bible. And I hope you'll be with us. Thank you. God bless.